Hi, and welcome to my talk, Cloud Orc, a portable sound card in the cloud. And so imagine that you have a synthesizer, right? And that the synthesizer is composed of multiple computers and they're all interconnected. Now, if you want to perform live with such a synthesizer, you'll have to take all the cabling and all the power and all that stuff, and you'll have to put on a dolly and take it to the venue and install it all. And you could get it wrong. But imagine that instead of that, you could just remotely access that network and stream the audio from the network to your phone, such that the only thing you need to take to the venue was you paid for a good internet connection and you had your phone with you. The way I propose dealing with this is by using cloud computing. And what cloud computing is like is basically like treating computation as a utility. That is, when you switch the light on and off in your office, you are using power provided to you from a utility that runs their own power generators. So utility in this case would be something like AWS or Cyvera, where they run virtual machines for you, which you can turn on or off. This means that you aren't buying, procuring, configuring, and networking all of these computers. You're just getting them provisioned, and they're provided to you. So when I'm talking about cloud computing in this presentation, it's about virtual machines that you can provision. The problem with being able to use, like, say, 1,000 CPU cloud computer to generate audio would be that you can't hear it. None of these cloud computers have sound cards, so you have to export the audio somehow. Now, of course, you probably already solved the problem. Well, you stream audio and you stream it over the internet, but this will induce latency and reduce the interactivity of your synthesizer. Furthermore, you might exist within a context such as firewalled computers, the lack of ability to use UDP, like on ng-rom, UDP ports are usually blocked. You might be geolocated. Also, you might face portability issues. You might want your player to play on all devices, and you don't want them to install an app to do that. Furthermore, if you're doing it over the internet, there's a good chance that it's going to be forced over Ethernet at some point, and Ethernet has a maximal transmissible unit of 1,500 bytes, it's 100 megabit Ethernet or less. DSL tends to have an even lower MTU, and then when you combine this with the headers of your packets, your IP and your TCP packets, you're not leaving a lot of space for data, you're leaving 1,436. So when you send one byte, you send all those headers along. And then when you send 1,436 bytes, you still send those headers along. But if you try to send 1,437 bytes, it's going to fragment the IP packet, and you're going to get a long TCP packet, but it's going to be sent as two packets. The problem here, especially with TCP, is that you have to acknowledge it, and also the fragmentation can occur out of order, meaning that you wait even longer. If you send larger amounts, you would have to send more packets. Another issue we're dealing with is hard limits of physics. For instance, it takes light about 300,000 kilometers. In 1 second, it can travel 300,000 kilometers. From Edmonton to Heathrow is about 77,000 kilometers, so that's about 20 milliseconds if it was perfect conditions, or a 40 millisecond return time. The circumference of the Earth is 40,000 kilometers, and geostationary satellites are about at 40,000 kilometers. So these, all of these distances, they all take time to travel. Furthermore, when a packet travels, it might undergo jitter. It might not arrive on time, it might arrive early, might arrive late. In many cases, stuff will arrive late, but it might look like it arrived early if the last packet arrived late. Furthermore, all throughout the chain, the networking and the multimedia and encoding and decoding, there's buffering. usually buffer is used to hide jitter, and a small buffer will have low delay, but it won't hide a lot of jitter, whereas a big buffer will hide a lot of jitter, but it'll have high delay. A big buffer tends to be more efficient, you can do more work at once, and a small buffer is less efficient, but the latency will be a lot less. So if you really care about latency and performance, you really want to focus on the small buffers. Audio compression uses windows for analysis, and this windowing induces latency. So you might want to avoid audio compression altogether just to avoid that latency. So in this work, we're just sending the audio raw. So we're sending a mono 44 kilohertz stream and 32-bit floats. And the reason why we're doing that is because we can fill the HTML5 script processor buffers that are provided with the web audio. We send the audio over WebSockets, so there's less overhead. We also use XHTP requests to send like OSC messages. So so consider the fact that you have to send samples. You basically want to send the biggest packet you can that isn't going to induce too heavy latency. I recommend using powers of base 2 because that's usually an analysis unit. You don't have to. But the largest, in this scenario, the largest sample size that we can send without fragmenting packets and inducing fragments is 357 samples. The closest power 2 to that is 256, and that doesn't fragment. And so in this diagram, I show the packet header, the IP, the TCP, and the WebSocket header, and show you how it fragments. So once you hit over 375, there's generally going to be fragmentation, usually on DSL connections or worse. So the latency, is it any good? Can we use this for interactive stuff? So I set up an experiment where I talk to the cloud, I listen to the cloud with WebSockets, and I can send HTTP messages to the cloud. The cloud is basically connected via jack, and we'll send the ping from the browser, and it will get rendered and come back. So basically what happens is we start our ping test. Our ping test is listening to the cloud, and then we start our ping, and it sends a ping out to the ping web service, which then gets the synthesizer to play a ping sound. Ping sound is generated and mixed into the cloud mixer, and then the audio is transmitted back to the ping test that's listening. Then the time is reported to us. In the paper, I report median times. Locally, we get about 70 milliseconds, and that implies that maybe we can do better with the HTTP requests. Cable modem over here in the UK, I was able to get 260 milliseconds. On EduRoam, I'm getting about 300 milliseconds. So that means it's usable, not super interactive, but usable enough. For a demo, what I provided was a distributed granular synth. So I had 14 grains in the cloud, and they were summed by a mixer, and then that mixer would send the audio out. So we had basically a jack in the cloud, and then we would have HTTP to export the audio. And so we'd also be able to control the granular synthesis with XHTML requests that would really just send OSC messages off and ferry them. So you've heard about the cloud stuff. I talked about the granular synthesis instrument. You're wondering, well, how should I use the cloud if I'm going to use it? Well, you should consider the structure of your network. A star formation tends to be low latency. It has high network bandwidth to the center node, and it doesn't scale that well, but you'll get the lowest latency from your cloud. If you want to do more than, say, 20 VMs in the cloud all transmitting audio data, I recommend that kind of tree formation. But every time you make the links deeper, you incur high latency, as well as it scales better. But in general, you should consider that locality matters. You want to keep things as local as possible. Inside a VM always has lower latency, But one thing you could do with these VMs is use them for analysis technique, for analysis like computer vision and music information retrieval, and then keep the rendering local, but use the analysis that you farm out to the cloud. So in conclusion, I proposed a cloud instrument that avoids heavy setup. I addressed issues of latency and delay, and I discussed how to avoid heavy buffering. I tested the latency through numerous locations, and I demonstrate in the paper, and I provide source code to demonstrate how to set up a cloud instrument that is successful, and this all exploits HTML5. Thanks.